I have the great privilege of being the moderator for our second panel. Thanks so much to the organisers for inviting me, and thanks to Barbara and other colleagues for setting the scene so well and setting out the challenges and the opportunities that face us so articulately. Thanks for that. I'm a partner in an organisation called PwC, which is a big financial services organisation, and I think I can hear some of you thinking, what on earth has PwC got to do with girls education? And just in case any of you happen to be thinking that, Pauline asked me just at the beginning to say a few words about where an organisation like PwC fits in to this. So some of you may have heard of the Girls Education Challenge, which is a big programme run by the UK's Department for International Development. And that's essentially a £300 million fund that DFID have established in order to spend on girls' education. And we have been acting for DFID as the fund manager in relation to what we call the GEC, the Girls' Education Challenge. And what that means is that our responsibility as PwC is to work collaboratively with our colleagues in DFID to ensure that that pot of money is spent on the right things at the right time, and it is monitored effectively in order to drive value for money. And I've had the great pleasure and privilege and challenge over the last 2 or 3 years of leading that programme on behalf of PwC. And it's been a challenge. You know, at the beginning, I remember we had a discussion with Mark Lowcock, who's the DFID Permanent Secretary, about payment by results. And he said, yeah, look, we have to do payment by results in this programme, you know, and we all agreed with him enthusiastically, and then we went back to the office and went, right, how are we going to do this? And we spent a long time actually trying to make payment by results a reality on the programme. And time will tell. Time will tell as to whether or not it is driving value in a programme of this nature. But that's my role in relation to girls' education. I feel humbled and privileged to be in such esteemed company today. I did, about nearly to the day, 25 years ago, I studied a master's in economics at Oxford University, the so-called other place. And I did an MPhil thesis on the links between maternal education in Kenya and child health outcomes. And back then, if you had said to me, right, David, in 25 years' time, you're going to be at a session like this talking about girls' education, I don't think I would have quite believed you. But look, that's a little bit of background about myself and where I fit into the thing. I have, well, it's clear from the first session that you guys are a very informed, articulate and well-intentioned, I have to say, audience. And this session in the little agenda and briefing papers that I have is billed as an interactive session, and I'm really going to try and do my best to get as many questions and comments from the floor. But before I do, I wanted to just spend a little time introducing our three panel members. And if it's okay, I was going to ask them one introductory question each, just to get the ball rolling, and then we'll see where we get to. So is there anything by way of background or anything? Is that okay? Yeah? Okay. So Pauline Rose in the middle. Pauline Rose. So Pauline is Professor of International Education at this great university and is also in a very real sense my client, because Pauline sits on the steering committee for the Girls Education Challenge. And probably 2 or 3 times every year, we have steering committee meetings. And the steering committee consists of some external stakeholders like Pauline and a bunch of other very senior DFID people. So those days, those steering committee meetings are really big days in my calendar, because it's important for me as the leader of this programme that those meetings go well, because we have to go and give an account of ourselves to DFID for how the programme's going. And if I'm being honest, and I see some DFID colleagues in the room as well, some of the meetings have gone better than others. But what I would say is that Pauline's voice throughout those meetings has been unerringly focused on the data and the evidence that we are generating. And she has pushed us at every meeting in terms of the quality and integrity of what we're generating through the programme and encouraging us to start to get the messages out about what's working and what doesn't seem to be working. So that's Pauline. Lucy Lake, probably needs no introduction in this place and in this town, but let me try. So Lucy is the CEO of CAMFED. Now, I met Lucy, two or three years ago for the first time at an event that we ran in our building in London, which was really launching the first set of GEC projects, because CAMFED are running two projects amongst, that would be a portfolio of 37 projects across 18 countries in that programme. And, you know, one of my jobs as the sort of the head of the fund manager team is to release the money from the bank account, the GEC bank account, into the bank accounts of people like CAMFED. And so I sort of think I'm probably quite an important stakeholder, and you know, but anyway, as part of that process, a lot of people we work with thinks our sign off for that is completely over the top, and it's partly, but you'll just have to forgive us because we're accountants and we're all into the numbers and the finances. But you know, it goes through about three or four layers of sign off before the thing gets to me. But then on the day that I do the sign off, I get a narrative in relation to each of the projects. And, you know, let's say it's a very mixed bag that we have. It's a mixed portfolio. But touch wood, so far, in relation to the CAMFED projects, I have to say that that narrative has been universally strong and positive about the great work that CAMFED are doing. So I would encourage Lucy and her colleagues to stick at it, because there's clear evidence of CAMFED making a real difference through this program. And the only one of the panel who I did not know before today is Fiona. Fiona Mavinga. Mavinga, is that?
Correct, yeah? Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And Fiona is a lawyer and one of the founding members of CAMA. And I believe there's a little bit of information about CAMA in this lovely card. I think some of you had at your chairs. And CAMA is a network of women leaders across Africa. What is it, 30 plus thousand at the moment, with the aim to take it to over 100,000 in the next few years. It's a force to be reckoned with, of women leaders all focused on the issue of girls' education. And the focus that Fiona has is on issues like gender-based violence and discrimination, and some of the key things that we've already heard about that have a major impact on the education outcomes and subsequent life chances of marginalised girls. And I believe that some of the practical initiatives and strategies that Fiona has come up with have been recognised as good practice by organisations like UNGAI and others. So I think it's a very distinguished panel, and I'm delighted to have the opportunity to chair this session.